If a tree fell in a forest, did it make a sound? Well, I'm in the silly business of figuring it out, whether it did or not. And I do that using wireless sensor networks. And what are wireless sensor networks? Those are a bunch of tiny devices, sensors that are measuring temperature, humidity, and so on, all kinds of things about our environments. And there's even a term, it's called macroscope. It's not a microscope, but macro. It gives you the whole picture. And this term was coined at the research looking at redwood trees. Well, these are sequoias, but nevertheless, those are trees. And they found out that the ecosystem at the bottom of a tree is much different from the ecosystem at the top of a tree. And what I wonder is, how does that relate to us humans? And this is one reason why I am into wireless sensor networks. Here you can see me happily walking on an inhabited remote island in the Pacific Ocean, solar panel in one hand, box with sensors in the other, and I'm gonna set up wireless sensor network to figure out how the trees grow, how the grass, why is it that the grass doesn't grow under those brushes, under those shrubs? And I'm happy because I love that job. At the time, I didn't know that I had hepatitis C. In fact, that I had it for about 5 years. Thanks to medical advances, and after 1 year treatment, I'm fine now. So it's all good. But what I don't like is that we learn about things like that years after they have happened, they have begun, they have started. And hepatitis C is just one of the diseases like that. There is, most people don't know that they have diabetes and cardiovascular diseases and so on. And this is why I devote a considerable amount of my time and my career into wireless sensor networks for medical purposes, for learning about signs, vital signs of people, for learning about behavior of the people, to learn about us, to make the complete picture out of these dots that are a measurement, a sensor. And they can tell, they can make us better people, they can make us happier, they can make us healthier. And some people see benefit in that, even some money, right? But my point is that there is much more information in there. And there is so much information that we are actually not measuring, that goes by us. And the whole picture eludes us. We just take snapshots of points. Okay, I took a blood sample once a year, I took X-ray maybe 2 years ago, and so on. But the whole picture eludes us. We don't even know what the whole picture is. Well, this is a very nice picture, and I would like to have that picture about my health. Perhaps you can spot some trees behind there. So this is why I'm trying to connect those dots, to create new dots, new data from people, from us, from humans, and to bring us a bigger picture of health. Now, this is another picture, right? We don't have dots here, but we have words. This is my talk today. I could say thank you very much. This is what I wanted to say. Did you get it? Anyone? Probably not so much. Because the whole picture is not there. These are only dots. Those are only pixels. So for example, what happens when we go to a doctor? Hello, what is your problem? Oh, I have this horrible headache. How long did you have it? Maybe a month already? I'm not gonna say that there was a party last night and, you know, happens. So the doctor doesn't know the whole picture, doesn't even know the exact dots of the picture. And nevertheless, the doctor has to make an estimate, has to make the best treatment, and God forbid the doctor's gonna do something wrong, right? We don't have the whole picture of our health. And we have more problems with that, as you can see. And perhaps that is why about 150,000 Americans are misdiagnosed every year. That's the statistics based on the American Medical Association. And about one-third of them die. Because we don't have the whole picture. What we have, though, are sensors. We have sensors all around us. We have technology, amazing technology. You can see a hat with a sensor on the back that lets athletes figure out whether they had a concussion or not. Because often athletes are not gonna, they're gonna toughen it out, right? You can see the stretchable electronics on a baby, because baby is not gonna tell you how long did he have this or that problem, right? And all kinds of other sensors on the body, outside the body, in the environment, even sensing how we behave, you know. For example, I have Fitbit, right? And since I have it, I'm very happy to learn that I actually run a marathon, even a little bit more than that. Well, it took me about 7 days or so, but who cares? Right? So sensors like that are around us. And it's not just sensors. We have developments in research for big data, for health information systems, for image processing and analysis, for social networking and so on. We have so much going on that connecting it all together, a new field or area, so to say, has emerged. It's called digital healthcare. If you search YouTube for these keywords, and perhaps pause on here, you'll find a very nice video describing what it is in a nutshell as a starting point. So this is, I think, where the future is taking us, where the future should be taking us, and this is why I'm contributing there. So, are you with me? Yes? This is what we should do, right? This is what's gonna make us all healthier and happier and, you know, jumping around. Now, how about privacy? There's a picture of a website that I found very funny a few years ago. So basically, they created a website that scans Twitter tweets. And if you're not at home, let's say, oh, I'm in the restaurant. Oh, I'm shopping right now. Oh, I'm on the business trip right now. You know? What that means is, I'm not home. Please come rob me now. Right? So this is just one of the examples, right? We're happily using Google, Facebook, Twitter. We're going to supermarkets. We're buying all kinds of stuff. We're buying, you know, they could collect that information. Perhaps they even do. And they could tell a lot about us, the whole picture of our lives, perhaps, right? Of course, there are certain policies in place that prevent that to a reasonable level, hopefully so. Nevertheless, but my point is that we are giving up privacy already. So why don't we give it for a good cause? Not only we're giving up our privacy, we're giving up a privacy of our friends. There's a TripAdvisor application on Facebook, and if you sign up for it, well, all you need to do is give up some of your privacy and some of your friends' privacy, and then you can put, you know, dots on a map where you have been, and you know, it's a very good, healthy application, maybe, for a cause. So. Should we forget about privacy? Not really. I think we should deal with privacy. And there are ways to deal with it. Even besides the policies and rules and opt-in, opt-out schemes, there are mathematical tools and research done how to obscure privacy and yet get the results. For example, in this picture, you can see, suppose we're taking our blood tests or pulse, and we are submitting that to a database. However, before submitting to a database, we are adding some sort of noise to it, right? So if my pulse is 90 about right now, probably, then the database might get 121, right? What we all know, that's not true. That's not my correct pulse. However, if you aggregate all the data, you can still tell trends from people, from many people submitting data to this database. You can tell trends over the area, over a certain time, over certain diseases, onsets, and so on. And you can get early warnings and better diagnosis, because you can see trends in longitudinal studies. There's also an economical aspect. For example, there's an antiviral drug, it's called Tamiflu. Perhaps you have heard about it. Maybe you've even heard that United States and United Kingdom and perhaps some other countries have been stocking up on it and spending billions, you know, on it. However, there's analysis by Cochrane study that shows that the flu, usually it's about weeks, 7 days, right? is shortened only by half a day for adults, if you're using this drug, or one day for children. So that seems to be a bit of waste. Okay, I'm going to take this medicine and I'm not going to be ill for 7 days, but 6.5 days. There's also a good example. Many good examples. This is one of them. There's a study for autism. Suppose a person has a child with autism. An obvious question for that person is, very crucial one is, will my second child have autism? What are the chances? So therefore, a study in Sweden, taking into account about 2 million children, out of which about 14,000 had diagnosed with autism, took place over the course of 8 years. And what they found out was quite surprising. You would imagine that autism comes from genetic factors, mostly. As it turns out, it's about 50-50. The other 50 is environment. This study enabled us to figure that out. The point is, now we know that we should spend more research time and resources on environmental factors as well. So if you're with me on these issues, I invite you to practice what you preach. Consider sharing. Suppose you are giving or getting your data, medical data. Don't keep it to yourself. To a reasonable degree, of course. Deal with privacy. There are ways how to deal with privacy. There are policies, opt-in, opt-out, and so on. Encourage and create tools and sites, websites, and communities that talk about this issue, that actually collect data. It doesn't have to be personal. It can be anonymous data. But nevertheless, it's going to be very useful for research. It's going to be the paradigm shift in medicine, I believe so. And find the joy in giving up some privacy. The joy of healthy children. So, let's see what the future holds for us. Okay? In the future, I don't need these anymore. I might need these, though. All right? So, what's up, Glass? Oh, you've been watching my blood sugar. It's too low. You want me to go around the corner to that pizza? Don't you find something more, you know, healthy for me to eat to increase sugar? Oh, they pay better for advertising. Well, you know what? You still have lots of things to improve in your service. Oh, what else? My posture is not right here? Let me see. Okay, yes, you might be right. I should probably not walk like that. You know, I should stand still, straight. What we see here is a wireless sensor network. I have about 64 sensors on my back, and this is the actual shape of my back in real time. So this could be good for a number of applications, for people having scoliosis, for athletes trying to train in the better way, and so on. If a tree fell in a forest, let me rephrase. If a person fell, and there was nobody there, does it matter? Thank you.